that are now spirit, that God makes enough of us to give us a word from him.
Yeah.
Anybody happy on this evening because the Lord has you on his mind?
Yeah.
And just in case you don't know tonight, you are on the mind of the Lord.
Thank you. Thank you. separate to build us more separate in 65 years. That's a long time. That's a big blessing. God is amazing. And he's been amazing in the lives and the ministries of this church. We thank God for this wonderful occasion and this opportunity to come and to fellowship with you. Thank God for your pastor, who is a friend, a dear friend. We thank God.
Amen.
Great ground. Come on, y'all. Give God praise.
Amen.
Each other for several years, and I thank God for the friendship, the relationship, and he's been a blessing not only to me, but also to my wife, but also to our son. And we thank God for the way that he's also gifted in music ministry. Amen.
Amen.
And I thank God for him, his wonderful wife, and beautiful daughter. Amen. And the discipleship of the Greater Harvest Church. It is again our joy and delight to be here sharing with you. We thank God for our music ministry who's come with us. Amen. Officers who are here. Thank God for each and every one who's come to share in this celebration. My wife is with me, and I'm so glad to have my baby. Who said you got to wait till Sunday morning? Amen. The same God who's God on Sunday is also an amazing God on Wednesday. In fact, there's somebody's testimony that he's keeping you right now. He's keeping you in the right mind, keeping you blessed and highly favored. So we are proud of what God is doing in the life of this church, proud of what God is doing through your pastor. We're excited about
Amen.
What's happening over here on the west side of Saratoga Street.
Yeah.
Amen. God's joy is good. And so he's been amazingly kind. Again, 65 years is no small thing. And God has blessed
Amen.
His congregation to keep her doors open.
Yes.
While many churches
Amen.
And many congregations are finding it tremendously difficult. In fact, hundreds are closing their doors every month. Yet God's been good to Greater Harvest for 65 years. Certainly not our intention to keep you long tonight, but I would that you would turn with me in your Bibles or on your Bible app to Mark chapter 4. It's a familiar passage. Mark chapter 4, find verse number 35. Amen. It's always good to see Stephen Jones Jr. Amen. I saw Steve on the drums. I'm like, oh, shucks, man. So thank God for friendship, relationship between Stephen and my son. Thank God for the way God is using and blessing him. Amen.
Amen.
Mark chapter 4, if you're able to stand, if you wouldn't mind standing with us as we respect the reading of God's word. Mark chapter 4, find verse number 35. I'm reading from the New King James Version. If you got it, say, I got it, preacher. Here's how these verses read on the same day. Let the church say the same day. When evening had come, he said to them, let us cross over to the other side. When they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was, and other little boats were also with him. And a great windstorm arose. The waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling. But Jesus was in the stern, asleep on the pillow. They awoke him and said to him, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing, that we are dying? Then Jesus arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace. Be still. And the wind ceased. There was a great calm, but he said to them, why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said to one another, who can this be? That even the wind and the sea obey him. You You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I want to preach just for a few minutes from this title, this thought, this tag. I want to preach about lessons from a storm. Lessons from a storm.
Yes.
Turn and tell your neighbor, tell you, you can learn some things from your storm.
Yes, sir.
Father, I hope is in you. I trust is in you. We know that some trust in chariots and some in horses. But on tonight, we trust in your powerful and mighty name. God, we've gathered in this place that we call Greater Harvest to worship you, to serve you, to hear from your word. God, we know where each of us is, not just in terms of geography, longitude, and latitude, but you know where each of us is emotionally. You know where each of us is in terms of the state of our affairs, in terms of our relationships, our finances. You know where each of us is. So God, I pray that you'll arrest our attention, that you will speak to us. God, I pray that you will find pleasure in speaking to and through this your preacher. God, take this mind that you've given me and think with it. Take this voice and use it for your glory. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen.
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 Amen. Lessons from a storm.
Yeah.
In the text, the disciples are attempting to cross the Sea of Galilee. And the Sea of Galilee is just like life sometimes. The Sea of Galilee, just like life, can be calm one moment. And then seemingly out of nowhere, a storm can show up. There's some of us in this room right now who have survived our share of southern storms. We've survived our seasons where things seem to be A-OK one moment. And then seemingly with the blink of an eye, a storm comes out of nowhere. If I'm preaching your testimony, come on, and we've got to preach it in the building. Some of us have survived our share brink of sudden storms, political storms, racial storms, financial storms, relationship storms, health-related storms, work-related storms, school-related storms, and even weather-related storms.
Yeah.
2017 Atlantic hurricane season was a hyperactive, deadly, and extremely destructive season, featuring 17 named storms, including 10 hurricanes, which occurred one right after the other. And yet, by the grace of our amazing God, we survived them all. I wish I had some confidence. In fact, you may be the only one on your row who recognizes that you are a survivor. So I dare you to look down your row, and I dare you to look at your neighbor and point to yourself and tell your neighbor, I'm a survivor. Tell him I'm a survivor, because your neighbor may be wondering what a survivor looks like. And maybe God put you on that pew, on that row, so that your neighbor would get a glimpse of a survivor. I don't need everybody, but I need somebody in greater office on a Wednesday night who knows by the grace of God you have survived some storms that had some names, and you survived some storms that you have no idea what to call them. Do I have a witness in the building? You have been a survivor of some storms that seem to come out of nowhere, but by the grace of God, you and I have survived them all. Come on, take about 20 seconds and put your hands together and give God some praise for every single storm that you have survived. See, the devil thought he was going to take you out, but by the grace of God, you survived every storm. The devil tried to steal your joy, but by the grace of God, you survived every storm. The devil tried to steal your peace, but by the grace of God, you survived every storm. The devil tried to take your testimony. the storm. But I've learned some lessons from my storm. As a matter of fact, we look at this narrative, Steve. In my storms reveals a whole lot. Because often what God does is God prepares us before the storm. So that when we're in the storm, Robert, it becomes an opportunity for us to demonstrate what we've learned before the storm. In other words, God will be in the time where he'll be giving instructions. And then following the instructions always comes a test. And often when it comes to the storms that you and I have had to deal with, God has before the storm shared some things with us that are designed to help us to make it through the storm. So our response to the storm revealed some things. See, Jesus has been teaching the disciples on the shore about the kingdom of God. Some of y'all missed it. He was teaching them close to the shore about the kingdom. But the test did not come until they got out of the sea. See, when they were close to the shore, it was teaching time. But when they were out at sea, it was testing time. I know you just like me wish God would test you while you're on the safety of the shore. But God said, sometimes I got to wait until I get you out in the deep. I got to get you out in a place where you can't depend on anybody else but me. And when you're out there, you got to put into practice what I already told you. If there anybody in the house on this Wednesday evening who knows God's been teaching you some things, he was teaching them about the kingdom, and watch this, whatever he's been teaching you in advance of the storm is designed to help you to make it through the storm, that he was teaching them about the kingdom of God. Our response in the storm reveals whether or not we've been paying attention. Our response in the storm reveals whether or not we've learned the lesson, whether or not we've learned the lesson to trust God to take care of God's kingdom. Okay, I got to put it in reverse. Is there anybody in the building who has a testimony that God will take care of you? Come on, I need you to take a moment and just give God a praise offering in the building. Everything is going good. Everything is going well. It's easy to act like you got it on Sunday morning or on Wednesday night. But when you get to work on Monday morning or Thursday morning and the hellhounds are on your track, it's in the middle of the storm that our response reveals whether or not we learned the lesson, that they are panicking while Jesus is sleeping. Jesus being asleep is reflective of his undisturbed authority. It's as if Jesus is saying, even though the storm is raging, my authority is still undisturbed. I've got the same power in the storm that I've got on the shore. Whether you're at Golden Corral, in supplements, but you are still who you are. It's not determined by the wedding.
Yeah, come on, preacher.
Because you got the same power.
Yeah.
In a one-bedroom apartment. But you got a house in Roland Park. I wish I had a witness in the building. But I said, y'all, who you are is not determined on me. Jesus is asleep on a pillow. Y'all in the midst of the storm. I learned from the storm that our response is revelatory. We can learn another lesson from the storm. We can learn from our storms that storms don't have the last word. Storms don't have the last word. As a matter of fact, tell yourself, say it to yourself, storms don't have the last word. My troubles don't have the last word over my life. My storms do not have the last word over my life. You know who has the last word? God always has the last word. That's why when they woke Jesus up, they woke him up and they said, don't you even care that we are dying up here? And Jesus got up. And look at what Jesus does. Jesus conquers the storm with a word. As a matter of fact, it's three words. It's a phrase. Because Jesus is trying to show us that your storms will never have the last word over your life. Your storms were not designed to have all of your attention. The storms were not designed to be the to your life, because if your storms are the only voice you're hearing speaking in your life, you will stay discouraged and distraught. But if there's anybody in the building who knows that the word of God will always be louder in your life than the voice of your storms, Jesus gets up, goes out on the boat, and says, peace, be still. In other words, storms, you've been talking for too long. You've been making noise for too long. Jesus can turn the ship. who feels like